All right, so I'm going to talk about microscopic colitis. We'll start with clinical features. I'm going to do a case-based presentation. We don't have audience response system, but I'm going to pose questions to you to ask you to think about this case if it was in your office. So this is a 65-year-old lady with diarrhea. 10 weeks ago it started, but it's been slowly progressive. She's now having 3 to 5 watery bowel movements per day, including 1 or 2 overnight. She has mild abdominal pain that's relieved by a bowel movement. She passes mucus, but no blood, and has lost about 10 pounds. So with this presentation, I want you to think about the title of my talk notwithstanding, how likely is it that she has microscopic colitis? Does she have irritable bowel syndrome? What additional history would you ask? And does she need a colonoscopy? And we'll go through each of those. So as you know, the hallmark of microscopic colitis is chronic watery diarrhea. About half of the patients will have abdominal pain, but it's typically mild. And about half will also have weight loss, and it's also typically mild. The more severe the weight loss, the more you need to think about other conditions such as celiac disease. So association with autoimmune conditions like diabetes and psoriasis and autoimmune thyroid disorders are common. But I think the one most important for a gastroenterologist is the association with celiac disease, and I'll go over that in a few slides. It's also very important to recognize that people with active microscopic colitis commonly meet the symptom-based criteria for irritable bowel syndrome. So in a study we did in Olmsted County, 50 to 70% of our microscopic colitis patients met the criteria for microscopic colitis. And in a post hoc analysis of collagenous colitis patients treated with budesonide in clinical trials, anywhere from 28 to 65% met the criteria for IBS. So you need to keep that in mind if you're using symptom-based criteria to make your diagnosis. And the other clinical feature that I think is particularly important is this entity of drug-induced microscopic colitis. NSAIDs you're all familiar with, and there are several other drugs that we'll talk about in a couple of slides. So given this significant overlap between microscopic colitis and IBS, can we predict who's likely to have microscopic colitis? Well, older age, female gender, and a shorter duration of diarrhea all predict microscopic colitis as opposed to irritable bowel syndrome. So for example, in a couple studies we did in Olmsted County, approaching 50% of patients with microscopic colitis had diarrhea less than 12 weeks. In other words, they come to the doctor sooner than patients with typical irritable bowel syndrome. This is a study out of France where they tried to compare microscopic colitis to functional diarrhea to irritable bowel syndrome. The difference in those last two being the presence or absence of abdominal pain. And you can see that there were a number of clinical features that were distinguishing between the three conditions, but none of them were so significant that you could use that as a diagnostic criterion on its own. And again, for the sake of time, I won't spend a lot of time on those two slides. So you know that there's two main subtypes of microscopic colitis, collagenous and lymphocytic colitis. They're really very similar clinically, demographically, histologically, in response to treatment. The only main difference being on the biopsies, whether you have thickened collagen band or not. So it's unclear whether these are different conditions or just part of a spectrum, and most people now consider them to be more or less the same disease with slightly different histology. Certainly treatment is not dictated by which subtype a person has. So here's that issue with celiac sprue. If you take patients with celiac disease and you biopsy their colon, about a third of them will have microscopic colitis-like changes. So is that microscopic colitis or is that so-called celiac colopathy? I'm not sure we can tell the difference. Peter may have some suggestions, but for me, if the changes persist on a gluten-free diet, then I treat it like microscopic colitis. On the other hand, if you take patients with microscopic colitis, anywhere from 2 to 13% will have celiac sprue. Some studies show even higher rate. Whatever the true rate is, it's much higher than the background population. So there does seem to be an association between the two. Importantly, celiac serologies may be less sensitive in microscopic colitis. And I don't know if that's an age phenomenon or what, but for me, if I'm trying to rule out celiac disease, I like to do a small bowel biopsy rather than serologies. And again, Peter may have a comment on that during the question and answer session. So when do you think about celiac disease? Well, certainly if they have steatorrhea, significant weight loss, iron deficiency anemia not otherwise explained. And a big one that I see is non-response to a typical microscopic colitis treatments. So I get a lot of phone calls and emails about a patient not responding to budesonide. And one of my first responses is, have you checked for celiac disease? All right, we'll shift gears now, go to epidemiology. If you look at patients referred to a colonoscopy suite for chronic diarrhea, anywhere from 7 to 20% will have microscopic colitis. And given the association with age, the older your population, the higher that percentage is likely to be, and the younger your population, the lower the percentage will be. Looking at it in traditional epidemiology terms, the incidence for each subtype is anywhere from 5 to 10 per 100,000. And that's on the same order of magnitude as Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. So pretty common condition, more common in the elderly, and more common in females. But in most studies, that gender association is more common or more striking for collagenous colitis than lymphocytic colitis. So here's an epi study we did in Olmsted County showing the age-specific incidence. And you can see younger than 60 years old, that's a pretty uncommon condition. In the 60 to 80 year old group, the incidence approaches 30 per 100,000, so very common in the elderly. And this is the time trend. From the mid 80s to the early 2000s, there was a significant increase in the incidence of microscopic colitis and both subtypes. But subsequently, we showed, and others have shown this as well, that the incidence appears to have stabilized. All right, so that's some background on clinical features and epidemiology. Let's go back to the case. This lady has hypertension, hypercholesterolemia, and GERD. She takes olmesartan, simvastatin, and omeprazole, denies any aspirin or NSAID use, and has no family history of any GI problems. So given that past history and medication list, what are your thoughts and what would you do at this point? And this brings me to pathophysiology, a number of studies trying to look at what are the mechanisms for microscopic colitis, and I don't have time to go through all of these, but from a clinician's perspective, I think the one that's most important is, again, this issue of drug-induced microscopic colitis. NSAIDs you're all aware of, and there are several other drugs that we'll mention here shortly. So this is a study now 10 years old where we looked at the entire literature on potential cases of drug-induced microscopic colitis and found high-level evidence. Now, this is the strength of the evidence. This is not necessarily how often these drugs cause microscopic colitis, but there was high-level evidence for things like aspirin, NSAIDs, PPIs, SSRIs, and intermediate level evidence for things like lisinopril and simvastatin. So I'll ask you, how many 60 and 70 year olds come to your office with diarrhea that are not on a PPI or an SSRI or aspirin or an NSAID? So this is really common, and it can sometimes be challenging to sort out, could this drug be causing the colitis or not? Then you want to look at the timing of the drug. If they've been on it for 10 years and they've had diarrhea for 10 weeks, it's probably not the drug. And then a group from Spain did a similar study, found similar things, NSAIDs, SSRIs, statins. Interestingly, they found patients with biopsy-negative chronic diarrhea also were associated with SSRIs and statins. So they raised the point that perhaps these drugs don't actually cause colitis, but make diarrhea worse and bring it to our attention. And then finally, a very large population-based registry of a Danish population showing pretty much the same thing. PPIs, NSAIDs, statins associated with microscopic colitis. So I think this is a real phenomenon, and I really do think it's worth time in the office when you see a patient with microscopic colitis to try to look very carefully at their medication list, including over-the-counter things like NSAIDs. Okay, so back to the case. She was on three drugs that have been associated with microscopic colitis. She stopped all of them for 6 weeks and had no improvement in her diarrhea. Does she need a colonoscopy? And if she has a colonoscopy, does she need biopsies? So this gets us into the diagnosis of microscopic colitis. Does she need colonoscopy? Well, she needs age-appropriate colon cancer screening, and don't miss the opportunity to screen for colon cancer in someone with GI symptoms. But what about just for diarrhea? Does she need a colonoscopy? She has weight loss. You can consider that an alarm feature. And even if we ignore the colon cancer implications, with this degree of diarrhea, you may elect to just give antidiarrheals first and see if she responds before you put her through an endoscopy with biopsies. Sometimes you'll see a patient that had a colonoscopy a year ago for colon cancer screening, now has diarrhea. Do you need to repeat a colonoscopy? There's several studies showing that sigmoidoscopy with biopsies, especially biopsies above the rectum, are sufficient in the vast majority of patients. So you don't necessarily need a full colonoscopy for diagnosis. Now here's an interesting new twist. If she gets colonoscopy, does she need biopsies? And before, a couple months ago, I didn't even have this question in my talk, but there was a study done out of the UK, and I saw at least one poster here at this meeting from Colorado looking at the same question. Can we predict, based on clinical grounds, who's likely to have functional diarrhea versus microscopic colitis? And in this study out of the UK, they found that age over 50, female gender, use of PPIs and NSAIDs, weight loss, and the absence of abdominal pain were all associated with the likelihood of microscopic colitis. And if you put those features together in a score, you can predict with a 90 to 94% sensitivity who's going to have microscopic colitis on biopsies. And perhaps more importantly, you can avoid biopsies in up to 50% of patients that don't have microscopic colitis, and therefore avoid the cost that's associated with biopsies. So very interesting, very provocative. We need additional validation studies to see if this really helps out in clinical practice. So back to the case, this lady, we stopped her medications. She didn't get better. She took loperamide up to 16 milligrams a day with no improvement. She has a colonoscopy that's grossly normal. And then she has biopsies showing this slide here. For those of you taking boards or research, I wouldn't be surprised if there was a question with a biopsy looking like this. And what you see here in the middle is too many inflammatory cells. They're mostly chronic cells like plasma cells and lymphocytes, but there's some eosinophils and a few neutrophils as well. But the hallmark here is the black spots in the surface epithelium, and even more prominent over here in a crypt. Those are intraepithelial lymphocytes. And that really defines the diagnosis, just like it does for celiac disease in the small bowel. So what about lymphocytic versus collagenous colitis? Here's the subepithelial collagen band. And the basic rule of thumb is if it's the thickness of one cell or smaller, it's normal. And if it's bigger than one cell, it's abnormal. And you can see this is pretty normal. So this is lymphocytic colitis. All right, so now we'll switch to treatment, and we'll start with bismuth. So this small open label study many years ago showed that bismuth, 8 tablets a day, was effective in 92% of patients with microscopic colitis. Importantly, the time to response you see there is 2 weeks. That's a mean time to response. So if someone comes to your office and says, yeah, I took a couple Pepto-Bismol for a couple of days and it didn't work, that's really not a sufficient trial. It should be at least 9 pills a day. I'll show you some evidence in a minute on that. And I like to give it for at least 4 weeks before I say it's not working. Interestingly, too, in this study, those that responded, 75% maintained a long-term response, which is in distinction to the data I'll show you with budesonide. Corresponding improvements in stool frequency, stool consistency, fecal weight, and even histology. So a very small study, but suggesting that there is a role for Pepto-Bismol in microscopic colitis. They followed that with a randomized controlled trial, again, very small, only 14 patients, suggesting response was 100% to bismuth, 0% for placebo, with improvement in stool frequency and histology. But this, as far as I can tell, has never been fully published, so we don't have stats and a lot of details. Now, finally, we just looked at our experience at Mayo with 64 patients. This is open label, not randomized, not controlled. This was about 25% of our patients with microscopic colitis were treated with Pepto-Bismol. About half lymphocytic, about half collagenous. Dose ranged from 6 to 9 tabs per day, and we assessed response at 8 weeks. We saw complete response in 48%, partial response in 32%, and non-response in only 20%, so pretty good response rate. And then when we broke it down by subgroup, we saw a couple of interesting things. Number one, there was a dose response. So for those treated with 9 tablets per day, the remission rate was 63%. Versus those treated with less than 9 per day was only a third. And then when we looked at diarrhea severity, patients with mild diarrhea, less than 5, had a complete remission rate of 69%, compared to only 40% or so for those with more severe diarrhea. So again, this is preliminary. It needs to be further analyzed and hopefully validated in other centers. But it suggests that maybe now we can actually predict which patients are likely to respond to bismuth. What about mesalamine? Here's an early randomized controlled trial where everyone with microscopic colitis was treated with 2.4 grams per day of mesalamine, and then they were randomized in an open label fashion to cholestyramine or not. This suggested that mesalamine was pretty good for lymphocytic colitis, and it didn't matter if they got cholestyramine or not. And in collagenous colitis, slightly less response, but much better if you added cholestyramine. Here's an open label study of mesalamine saying that it worked pretty well in lymphocytic colitis, maybe not so well in collagenous colitis. And then this is 3 very large clinical series, 2 for lymphocytic colitis, and these are the number of patients, 1 with collagenous colitis. And in these series, the response rate to mesalamine was a little bit disappointing, ranging from 35 to 42%. And in the series from Mayo, most of these responders were only partial responders. So really a mixed message on whether mesalamine is likely to work or not. Last year, Stefan Melki and colleagues from Europe published a well-done randomized controlled trial that perhaps gives us some better data to answer this question. These were all collagenous colitis patients, and they were randomized to budesonide 9 milligrams a day versus mesalamine 3 grams per day versus placebo. And they showed no matter how you measured response, whether it was frequency of bowel movement, something called the Hertzsprung criteria, or even histology, mesalamine was no better than placebo. And in fact, numerically, it was worse than placebo. So this study really calls into question whether there's any role for mesalamine in patients with microscopic colitis. All right, we'll move on to budesonide. As you know, this is the best studied medication in microscopic colitis. 4 placebo-controlled trials in collagenous colitis and 2 in lymphocytic colitis, all with pretty much the same study design, 9 milligrams per day for 8 weeks. Some of the studies tapered at the end, some didn't. And the response rate to budesonide averaged 85%, so very common to respond to budesonide versus anywhere from 12 to 40% for placebo. But unfortunately, despite this very high response rate, the majority of patients relapse when you stop the budesonide. Here's a Cochrane meta-analysis just showing that the effect size for budesonide response is 12. There aren't too many treatments in medicine where you get an effect size of 12 compared to placebo. So really no doubt that this drug works. Here's lymphocytic colitis at both 3 weeks and 6 weeks, where budesonide was superior to placebo, and another study in lymphocytic colitis showing across a variety of endpoints, budesonide was superior to placebo. So our patient was treated with bismuth. She didn't respond. She was treated with budesonide, got better fairly quickly, and after a week, her symptoms resolved. She finished her 8-week course of budesonide, and 3 weeks later, she calls you up that her diarrhea has returned. So what's going on here? Does she need a repeat colonoscopy? Does she need repeat biopsies? And how would you treat this patient? So that brings us to the natural history of steroid-treated microscopic colitis. This is a retrospective study we did at Mayo showing that the remission rate to either budesonide or prednisone was 76%. Response rate 20%, so only 4% of patients had no significant response to budesonide. So when I hear about a budesonide refractory patient, I really wonder whether we have the right diagnosis, or are we missing something like drug-induced microscopic colitis and they're still on the drug, or are we missing celiac disease? Now this practice has been studied in 2 well-done placebo-controlled trials. Both of them induced remission with 9 milligrams per day of budesonide and then randomized for remission to budesonide 6 milligrams per day or placebo. And through 6 months, budesonide was clearly superior to placebo. Unfortunately, when you stop it after even 6 months of therapy, they still have a very high rate of relapse off medication. Here's the meta-analysis showing the odds ratio for maintaining remission on budesonide is almost 9 times higher than placebo. All right, so for patients who you treat with long-term budesonide, what do you monitor for? What dose do you use? Do you give them any special instructions? And are there alternate treatments for those who don't tolerate or don't respond to budesonide? All right, you still need to monitor for steroid-related side effects. There's no doubt that budesonide is safer than prednisone, but it is clearly not without steroid-related side effects. I use the lowest effective dose possible. I typically re-induce with 6 milligrams per day, get them well for a couple of weeks, and then I taper to 3 milligrams a day. And then I might even try tapering to 3 milligrams every other day. And then I stop at the lowest effective dose. I typically treat for about a year, and then I try stopping and seeing if they need long-term therapy or not. Special instructions, remember that drugs that alter P450 metabolism will alter budesonide metabolism, perhaps predisposed to steroid-related side effects. So they should avoid grapefruit, echinacea, and any drugs that modify the P450 system. What about alternate treatments? For the sake of time, I'm going to skip through these fairly quickly. Here's a small study saying azathioprine was effective. Slightly larger study from Europe saying a high rate of intolerance, but those that tolerated had a pretty good response rate compared to non-response. Methotrexate, 2 small studies, one saying it might be effective, the other one saying not really. Anti-TNF, 4 patients treated with infliximab, good response. 3 patients treated with adalimumab, 2 out of 3 responded. So So that's the extent of the world's literature on things like azathioprine, methotrexate, and anti-TNF. There's really not much reported. But putting it all together, this is my approach to the treatment of microscopic colitis. Look for things like NSAIDs and other drugs that might be implicated as causing the colitis. Stop it if you can. Mild symptoms may be treat with antidiarrheals, moderate bismuth, severe with budesonide, or if they don't respond to bismuth, budesonide. You expect a very high rate of response, but you also expect a high rate of relapse when you stop budesonide. And this little curved arrow just suggests using budesonide maintenance therapy for the at the lowest effective dose. Bile acid binders probably have a role, but it's not well clarified yet in the literature. Things like prednisone, immunomodulators, anti-TNF, and surgery are used in a very small percent of patients. So in summary, the incidence of microscopic colitis appears to have stabilized. Think about celiac disease. Think about drug-induced microscopic colitis. Most of the time, you're going to treat with bismuth or budesonide, but use the right dose for the right duration. Remember that if you use budesonide, there's a very high likelihood you'll need maintenance therapy, in which case you should monitor for steroid-related side effects. So I'm going to stop there. I'll ask Carol to come on up.